And thank you all for joining us for the second in our series of Great Lakes Coffee Hour discussions to talk about issues of significant importance to the Great Lakes region. I am Erica Jensen, the Executive Director of the Great Lakes Commission, and I'm pleased to be able to bring you these sessions as part of the Commission's annual Great Lakes Day events. For those of you not familiar, the Great Lakes Commission is a binational agency established in 1955 to protect the Great Lakes and the economies and ecosystems they support. It is comprised of appointed commissioners from each of the 8 Great Lakes states and 2 provinces. And we're pleased to be able to provide a forum for Great Lakes stakeholders to gather and work together on efforts that strengthen the Great Lakes region and protect and restore our world's largest system of fresh water. While normally we would be hosting our Great Lakes Day events in Washington, D.C. in person with all of you, but that was unfortunately not possible again this year. That said, we are still excited to be working with several of our regional partners to put together these virtual events that highlight the importance of and excitement around Great Lakes issues. Throughout this week, you will hear from members of Congress, the Canadian Parliament, experts in maritime transportation, state natural resource leaders, and mayors that are on the front lines of coastal and climate resilience in the region. Before we move into our topic this morning, I want to briefly cover a few logistical items. Attendees will remain in listen-only mode throughout the event to minimize disruptions. This event is being recorded and will be made available at a later date on the Commission's YouTube channel. And if you are having technical difficulties, you can message the meeting host for assistance. And finally, if time allows, we may take 1 or 2 questions from the audience. If you do have a question for our panelists, you may submit it through the Q&A function on Zoom. So with that, this morning's session is focused on leveraging the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Maritime Transportation System, a key economic driver for not just our region, but for the entirety of North America. Maritime cargo and vessel activities generate more than $45 billion of economic activity annually, supporting more than 300,000 jobs in the US and Canada. This includes a diverse array of ports across the region, and we're pleased to have several port representatives joining us this morning. We have all felt the impacts of supply chain disruptions over the past 2 years and recognize the importance of investing in the infrastructure that supports supply chain resilience. The Great Lakes Maritime System represents a prime opportunity to leverage the geographic benefits provided by the lakes. And we are fortunate to have many forward-thinking partners in the port and shipping industries who are already investing in infrastructure and practices to adapt to new challenges and take advantage of new opportunities in containerization, communications, and cruising. The future of Great Lakes Maritime Transportation for both cargo and passengers looks bright. We're pleased to host this morning's discussion along with the American Great Lakes Ports Association, an organization that works to influence public policies with the goal of fostering maritime commerce and related employment in the Great Lakes region, and the Great Lakes and St. Lawrence Governors and Premiers, an organization that supports the states and provinces' efforts to grow the Great Lakes regional economy. And so it's my pleasure to introduce my colleague and the Executive Director of the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Governors and Premiers, David Nafsker, to say a few more words of welcome.
Thank you, Erica, and good morning to everyone. Thank you very much for joining this morning's conversation, which is an important one about maritime transportation. We've got a terrific group of speakers and in some ways the wind at our backs with some recent successes, including full federal funding for the Soo Locks. Erica touched on a number of different topics that we're gonna look forward to our experts talking about this morning. But I think as important as all of that is the spirit with which we come to this conversation, which is one of partnership, collaboration, working together. We've accomplished some great things. Working together, we can do a lot more. To moderate the discussion, I will recognize one of our region's leaders, the president and CEO of the Port of Cleveland, Will Friedman. Will has been a great partner. He has taken risks and I think is one of the real visionaries for thinking about what the future of the system could be and what's possible. If we challenge ourselves in that way, I think we can imagine a different future than the one we've had in the past and one that's exciting and how we can work together to get there. So with that, I'll turn it over to our moderator, Will Friedman.
Good morning, everybody. Thank you, Dave. Thank you, Erica. It's great to be with you. Thanks for those opening remarks. We're going to jump right in and go right to our panelists. And I want to thank all three of you for being with us this morning, particularly Congressman Stauber, taking time out of your busy schedule there in the nation's capital. We appreciate it. As you've heard, we're going to talk about the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Seaway Maritime Transportation System this morning and how it can be more and do more for our respective states and regions. So I think what I'll do here is we'll just open it up going around to each of you. I'll start with the Congressman and just riff a little bit, if you will, for a few minutes on your thoughts, your initial thoughts on this topic. Before I hand the football over here to the Congressman, I should do a little bit of a better job on introductions. Congressman Stauber represents the 8th District of Minnesota, which includes, of course, Duluth, Port of Duluth, as well as the all-important iron ore mining range in Northeast Minnesota. Deb DeLuca is the executive director of the Duluth Seaway Port Authority, as well as the chair of the Minnesota Association of Ports. Von Dakota heads up the Ports of Indiana, which includes Burns Harbor on Lake Michigan in Northwest Indiana. And he's also currently chairing American Great Lakes Ports Association. So thanks again to all of you. So with that, I'll go over to you, Congressman. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much. It is great to be with you all. You know, as a former member of the Duluth Seaway Port Authority, Vanta and Deb, I worked with them closely. Two great professionals doing a great job in their respective arenas currently today. I am very, very happy to be with you. As I said, I'm excited about the opportunity that the Great Lakes can and will bring. I think that it's important. You had alluded to making sure that the funding is there for the Sioux Locks, incredibly important. We've got to get that project over the finish line. And I've said in government, it's not over till it's over, till that new lock is there. And I think it's important that we recognize that. We have in the Port of Duluth, and I think other ports, we look at the possibility for containers to be brought in that fit within the Sioux Locks. We have the ability, being the most inland port, we have the ability to bring those commodities to the Midwest where they don't have to be, trucked, et cetera, so far. So the sky's the limit for our Great Lakes system. We have to look at on one side of the equation, we have to look at the invasive species issue that's happening. We have to make sure that we invest in our locks and dams. We have to make sure that our dredging happens. So there's one thing that I learned early on in the Seaway Port Authority that how important dredging is. It's a huge part of that maritime traffic. It's all, the dredging is so important for the economic benefit of the carriers and the region. And we are very proud in the Port of Duluth to have the Iron Range, which mines the iron ore that makes close to 82% of this nation's steel, which is a strategic national security issue. So, and it brings it down to the lower Great Lakes. So I just think that the opportunities are there. We're going to have the opportunity and we're looking at the Great Lakes be a part of their recreation, the tourism industry, the touring boats, the ships that come in. We have to work with our Customs and Border Patrol to make that happen. And I know Deb is working on that in the city of Duluth with our officials. So I'm really excited. I'm very, very proud of the Great Lakes. I'm proud of our Port of Duluth. And I'm sure everybody on this Zoom is proud of the port that they represent or they're working at. And I have to say that Deb DeLuca is doing a fantastic job in the Port of Duluth. She took over the helm from Vanta, and it's just a really, really good opportunity. A lot of positive vibes. In the Port of Duluth, we have what we call the can of worms. It's a major, major intersection that we're working on to make sure that these commodities that come in, we can get them to the Midwest and throughout the nation as needed. So I am 100% committed to the port, the investment, and I understand the economic benefit as do my colleagues here. So I'll just leave it at that, and I look forward to questions. And just so you know, I have to leave just before the bottom of the hour.
Okay, got it. Thank you, Congressman. Really appreciate your optimism, and you clearly have your arms around the issues, and you've been supportive. So we can't ask for more. So thanks very much for opening things up with those remarks. Deb, why don't we move to you, and you can share with us what's top of mind for you regarding our transportation system.
Good morning, and thanks for having me. I'm very eager for this conversation. In fact, it's hard to know where to start. But I guess we have to start by saying that this system of ports, the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Seaway system, presents very real opportunities to strengthen and diversify our nation's supply chain and to provide more resiliency to the system. You know, if we look at what's happened over the past year, couple of years, we've seen the global supply chain disruptions coupled with increasing concerns for emissions driven by the global warming and increasing frequency and intensity of storms. And I mean, we'll have to look no further than the system for an answer for all of those pieces. I think a lot of the solutions that are being proposed right now for the global supply chain disruptions in our country are looking at a handful of coastal ports. And I think the definition of crazy is if you keep doing the same thing you've been doing and expecting different outcomes. So here we are pouring money into these coastal ports where we should be looking at how can we kind of blend our system between that centralized supply chain system and a decentralized, more diversified system. So the Great Lakes, if you look at it, the longer you make the water leg of any freight journey, the more environmentally efficient it is and the more economically efficient it is. And that's what, you know, if you bring goods into Cleveland, Willsport, or any Avantas, Burns Harbor or Duluth, you're lengthening that water leg of the journey. You're shortening the land side piece. On top of that, all of our ports are free flowing, are relatively free flowing multimodal transportation hubs compared to those at the coasts. So I think we should be looking at really creative solutions for expanding the use of the system. And I think we're going to get there in this discussion. So I'd like to, you know, and then Congressman Stauber talked about the importance of maintenance, whether that's dredging, icebreaking assets, breakwaters, and the like. And I think I'll pass it over to Vanta because we have some very similar themes, and I'll see where he goes with it, and then we'll cover the rest of it in the questions. But thank you very much.
Yeah, well, if you don't mind, I'll just jump right in. Deb's right. We've worked together long enough to know our system has capacity, and that's a very important statement and a very important thought. We live in a world where coastal ports have reached diminishing returns. The backups that we have seen along the coast, the great amount of freight redistribution is an issue and a problem that we could be a solution for. The supply chains that we operate in continue to grow. Peak freight is ahead of us, not now. This was all predicted 10 years ago, that the growth of freight across the country was going to meet these bounds. This pandemic that we've lived in over the past 2 years has done nothing more than accelerate many trends that we knew were coming. And yet it's a surprise. What we have the opportunity to do now with the $2 trillion in infrastructure is to rethink our system. And that's not just the Great Lakes system. That's all of our system. And Deb and I do key off of one another, and she's wrote a really, what I think was a brilliant piece in her North Star magazine of the fall. And I followed up with a brief snippet on our website under the headline of the report. And it just speaks to these issues. And so I believe that we should now turn it back over to Will and go through some of these questions, because I think we have a good group to speak to how to leverage our system.
Great. Thank you, Vanta. Well, you all three have raised some very intriguing and exciting ideas and possibilities. Let's drill in a little bit deeper. Embedded in all of this, the potential for the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Seaway Maritime Transportation System to play a bigger role, to be more important to our U.S. economy, is the role and the partnership with the federal government. Certainly, we've already had mention of the SULOCs and that project, which is so important to all of us, and we're of course gratified that the government is funding it. But what should this partnership look like going forward? What can the government do? Just yesterday, I think there was a statement that came out from the White House regarding urging reform of the Shipping Act, Ocean Shipping Act, and potentially tighter regulation of the international container lines. But that won't necessarily drive cargo to the Great Lakes St. Lawrence Seaway. And as Deb mentioned, I think perceptively, we're kind of doubling down so far on the let's just stuff more cargo through the big port, the big coastal port strategy. We'll start with the Congressman, because I know your time is short. Any thoughts on how you think the federal government can work with us in our ports, in our regions, in our states to try to drive some more of this commerce our way?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think that it's been alluded to earlier in my earlier statement. We have to, the federal government, in regards to the Customs and Border Patrol, for example, we have the ability to bring in shipping containers in the Port of Duluth. What we need is to make sure if they're international, we have to have the capacity from the Customs and Border Patrol to do the inspections in a timely fashion, in a reasonable timely fashion, and then get them to where they need to go. If you look at the railway in Rainier, Minnesota, that CN's busiest crossing, the Customs and Border Patrol has really brought forth a great project on how they screen product coming in. And we have to be able to let the federal government in that arena say, we can do it on the Great Lakes. And how do we do it? And I'm okay if we try a pilot project of some sort, but let's start it, because it's going to be successful. As Deb alluded to, you're going to bring those commodities to the heart of America through the Great Lakes. And it's going to reduce the trucking, et cetera, the distance rather. So we have the ability to do that. The federal government has to have the will to work with the Great Lakes Association, the Maritime Association, and to be able to do that. And I'm all in on it. I see that in a small capacity within the Duluth port with the cruising ships. We're working that, and sometimes there's some hurdles to go through. There shouldn't be those big hurdles to have these projects go forward. So I am committed to working with the Customs and Border Patrol. I think that's, if we don't have that, everything else we can put in place, the international relations that we have could be devastating. So I just think that's why I say the opportunity's there. I'm excited about it. And I know this group is too. And by the way, you all know the Great Lakes Caucus members would say the exact same thing I'm saying right now. We have the potential to do it.
Great. Thank you. Great points. And absolutely, on the custom side, we at least need a level playing field with the coastal ports. Deb, Vanta, do you want to follow up on that theme?
I'll jump in. You hit several issues that are very important. Custom Border Patrol, one size does not fit all. The Great Lakes needs a pathway to get on that super highway. The concentration and thought around maritime facilities for the Great Lakes cannot be what's happening at the coast. This is a developing business. It's something that we can do. Certainly Cleveland's proved that. Duluth is proving that today. So let's give all of our ports the ability to do that so that we can build a true network. Let's start encouraging export, right? So the export market right now is fed through the coastal ports, and we need to work with our congressional leaders to identify that. A big export for the United States is ag, and where is that coming from? It's largely from our region. So we need to have a better focus on how to develop that market outbound the Great Lakes. We used to have it. I mean, up in Duluth, they used to have a bagging facility that went for export. You know, we got somehow ignored, and that's got to turn around. Over the course of a very short 10 years, we've spent something like $10 billion in dredging along coastal ports to make bigger and deeper, right? And that's nothing more than moving dirt. I mean, that's not infrastructure, that's moving dirt. We need that kind of investment in the Great Lakes. And we can produce better economic results on those $10 billion than is happening. It's essentially, I'll use a former congressman from Minnesota who said, "What would you build a highway for a supersized truck that one manufacturer made?" And that's what we're doing. We're letting foreign built vessels dictate how we receive our freight. So I think that dynamic can be changed. And we have, as Deb pointed out, you keep it on the water for longer, the economics eventually play out, because we have to show our complete value chain in the move. And we're getting it broken up. So it's really the cost to the American consumer is hidden because of the way that freight moves.
If I can add on, my colleagues have hit on the Customs and Border Protection point, which I'd love to beat a dead horse, but I won't today. I think another way to look at this question, Will, is to look at the challenges that the system faces. And I know you're very aware of them. I think I learned some of them at your, you know, from you speaking so eloquently to them. But, you know, one is seasonality. It's a challenge that we have to acknowledge and deal with. Another is lack of familiarity. When we have shippers, steamship lines, and freight forwarders globally who aren't really aware of our system, they're understandably skittish of, you know, investing in going that route. And so we need to build familiarity of the system. Will, you've done a great job with that, with the direct liner service into Cleveland. And then just so for those of you listening, the direct liner service in Cleveland is specifically for containers. We're working, another problem with that lack of familiarity is exactly what Vanta said. The freight forwarders and shippers look at the cost of getting into the system, but they don't look at the cost of the entire transit all the way to their destination. So we need to be selling that at a higher level, that and establishing that more strongly. Along with that, we do have some extraordinary costs that we could be addressing, perhaps with, you know, should we be incentivizing? Should we be paying down seaway tolls and pilotage fees? as a sort of a pilot system to build traffic into the system, get that familiarity up so that they can see the advantages of our ports and how free-flowing they are. And along with that, one other, and I'm probably getting into another one of our topics, which is building container service on the Great Lakes. But one of the challenges we face there is lack of equipment, containers and ships. And again, is this something that we can incentivize? Can we develop, if you think about it, the big steamship lines are a little afraid of getting their containers lost in the middle of the continent. And so they're not as, they're reluctant to send them all the way in to Duluth, to Cleveland. Can we build out a private pool of Great Lakes containers? That would be something that would benefit the building of that system. So there's lots of opportunities to incentivize the system, to grow the system, and then and see the benefits that we've been talking about.
I'm going to be leaving here in just 30 seconds. May I just give you some final comments before I go? First off,
of course,
this conversation is it's really important, and these are things that we need to think of and we need to discuss and actually push forward on them. But I will just say on the side that you all may not be thinking. For example, we have Fraser Shipyards and other shipyards across the Great Lakes. You know, we have backed up naval vessels, years of backed up naval vessels that need maintenance and what have you. Representative Tiffany and I have put together a piece of legislation, and it's going through DOD because those naval vessels have to be, the maintenance has to be provided by law at their home port. We're trying, because of the backlog and for strategic national security, we're trying to bring those into the Great Lakes shipyards to have that maintenance, even if we can just get a couple, because the workers, they'll do great work, and that's another component that you don't know about, but we're doing that behind the scenes because those of us in the Great Lakes Caucus and that are representatives of the states surrounding the Great Lakes, we get it. I mean, that's part of the economy. So those are some things we're doing, to get some economic benefit to the shipbuilding the cities around the Great Lakes. And I think it's an opportunity. We're running up against some laws that we need to change if that's the case, because it is a national security issue. There's no reason we have to have our naval vessels backed up for 3 and 5, 7 years before they get maintained, and we can do that in the Great Lakes. So with that, I'm just going to sign off. Deb, Vonta, Will, everybody on this, Erica, thanks for Dave, thanks for having us. Just to appreciate us and know that this office stands ready, able, and willing to help the Great Lakes and the ports in any way, shape, or form, because you're the experts. Let's get some legislation that helps us, and our office is always open for that, and I appreciate you all.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Congressman, for joining us, and I know we'll be working with you closely in the near future.
Absolutely. Okay, take care. Bye-bye.
Bye. All right. We've had a number of things mentioned already, and I want to pick up on a couple of them and see if I can get Deb and Vonta to share some more of their thoughts with us. We have sort of an interesting divergence between the cruise industry right now, which seems eager to come into our system, building ships that fit into our system, recognizing the potential, recognizing that we have capacity and that the Great Lakes is a wonderful cruising grounds, which is really diametrically opposite of the large ocean carriers who I've had personal experience with telling me they have no interest in coming into our system, despite the fact that their own customers very much want them to serve our ports. And that's just a frustrating situation. I think it represents well the sort of, I'd go so far as to say sort of the market failure we're experiencing right now with the large container lines who do not respond to market signals. And it's never a good thing when companies don't respond to market signals, provide bad service, and yet make enormous profits. All those together can't be good. So how do we learn and leverage from the success we've had so far, and I think much more is coming on the cruise side, and apply that to container liner shipping, as well as other forms of cargo shipping that we may be able to grow here on the Great Lakes? I'm just throwing it out there to either of you.
Well, that was a lot. I'll hit kind of the analogy here. We do have a growing cruising business within the Great Lakes, and it's really fed by that specialty focused higher end kind of level within that marketplace. It's not going to be your huge Carnival coming into Venice and making Venice look really small. That's not what is capable here, which is what a lot of the cruising aficionados would like to see. They would like to see the smaller kind of attributes, which is exactly what we can provide. For our port, we're not really a cruise port. We're really an industrial port, but we have some very nice attributes around us. Chicago is not far away. The National Park of Indiana, our first national park, surrounds our industrial and port infrastructure. So it's a wonderful blend. It is the Kennedy Compromise as envisioned all those years ago. So those attributes, we have casinos that are right on shoreline. So all those attributes are important to a cruising destination. Now, jump over to how does that translate to the shipping in general? Well, the alliances have created havoc on small customers, mid-sized customers. They can't find their container, their box. You may book with a large company, Maersk, CMA, MSC, but that doesn't guarantee it's on an MSC vessel because of these alliances. Now, they have poor tracking, their boxes get lost, their visibility is diminished, and I believe that that's where we can provide a very concierge sort of service to the shipping community, people who are really cognizant of their shipments and watch them because they're important to their very business, versus, you know, a Walmart who can just go out and lease the whole vessel, right? They know it's there because the vessel's there. So I think that there's a vast market for us to take advantage of, both on cruising and on shipping.
Thanks, Vonta. Deb, did you want to add to that?
Yeah, let's see. Vonta, you went down such an interesting path. I got caught up in that. I'm thinking about the effort that there are several ports that are working together to look at how could we attract a container service into the lakes, because, as you know, Will has container capability at Cleveland. We have it at Port of Duluth. I think we're learning several lessons through that effort. One is that there is huge interest, but again, by shippers, by some of the smaller steamship lines, but also by non-vessel owners, carriers, and using the system. And part of it is helping them find their way here. Part of it is probably demonstrating for a season or two or three that this really works and it's going to transcend the pandemic bubble. And one of the lessons we've learned is we haven't really worked together on business development before. We've worked on marketing, but not business development, and that's something that we're doing. Another aspect with the container lessons is that we're hearing from those shippers and non-vessel operators and owners, sorry, that they're very interested. They're more, this is a more appealing system if there are more nodes available to pick up and drop off those containers. So that gets back to the Customs and Border Protection issue. We need some model to get more container ports built out more quickly. You know, those are just some of the additional ideas, I think, that where we can, where, what we can do to, and again, that sort of, that rides on some of the lessons that cruising's brought us. And I think the more traffic we get into the system, you know, the better it looks too.
Great, thank you. We have a question that is related from somebody in the audience. And the question is, how much excess capacity do U.S. Great Lakes ports have to absorb the backup from the coastal ports? So this gets to both capacity, which we've all mentioned here, and can we really be a relief valve for these large, very large container ports, Los Angeles, Long Beach, Savannah, New York, et cetera, here in the Great Lakes? You both touched on this a bit, but maybe speak a bit to just the question of capacity. I know we all know this topic and have our own ways of illustrating the available capacity here in our system.
Yeah, I guess I'll start off as I brought it up as a point. So our capacity, if we were to look across the system, and it's multi-pronged, as Will noted, and it's dependent on what port you go to. However, if we just look at the capacity through our locks and getting into the system, I think it's safe to say that we could triple the amount of vessels that go through our facilities, locking facilities today, and still be comfortable. And so from a perspective, the global capacity for what is essentially a Handymax vessel, which is seaway capable, is broader now because of the efforts of both the Canadian and the US side in hands-free mooring. So we really have the ability to handle much more, and I don't know if there's a tonnage that they're looking for as far as excess capacity, but we definitely could handle three times the amount of foreign vessels that we handle today. And Will could probably challenge me on maybe an exact number, but that's where I think we are.
And I'd like to add on to that, Will, because I think that's perfect on the maritime side, but don't overlook our land side connections.
Oh yeah.
What you're seeing at the coastal ports is, you know, the huge truck queues that you know, disrupt communities, have emission issues. Our ports are relatively free flowing here at our terminal. There is no truck queue. It's in and out. We're very efficient. So there's also, you know, our trucking lines in the area have been able to keep up with demand. They've delivered throughout this pandemic. So there's the chassis pools there, the land side connection. There's land available for warehouse build out in most of our communities. So our land side connections are strong and free flowing as well.
Very good point. I certainly would agree with both of you. I'm not sure it's possible or even that important to put a number on it. There's a lot of capacity in our system to absorb many more vessels and cargo. And I think for me, at least, the most important way to look at it is comparing our system, which does need some investment, but needs nothing close to the billions and billions of dollars that are necessary to try to make our large container ports more fluid. And I'm not even sure that's going to work. I my own opinion is it probably won't. So the cost per unit, container unit or ton or whatever you want to measure, to move cargo through our system is so much less than, you know, what it's going to take to move more cargo through the large container ports. So when you look at this from the national level, I think it's another reason why the federal government ought to be, you know, getting more bang for its buck by figuring out how to work with us to make our system better utilized. Another question, as we run down on time here, is an important one about ice breaking. Talk about the problem of inadequate ice breaking. How do we solve for that challenge? Any thoughts on that?
Fonta, are you going to take, you want me to do this one, or do you want to?
Well, Superior is the king of ice, so I'm not going to steal your thunder here.
All right. Well, the short version of this is that the U.S. Coast Guard takes care of ice breaking. The assets of the Great Lakes have been diminishing over the past several decades. We're down to, I forget the exact numbers, it's seven or nine ice breaking assets. Only one heavy, large icebreaker, and that's the Mackinac. And that's, you know, that's in for repairs. If you look at the smaller icebreakers, they're in for repairs all the time. And so there's a proposal before Congress right now. The new icebreaker that's the same size as the Mackinac that was authorized a couple of years ago, but we're still looking for the funding for that to happen. I don't have the number in my head. I don't have the number in my head right now for the cost of that icebreaker, but it's a very important asset for the Great Lakes. This winter, Duluth didn't have an icebreaking asset in the port either. So either going, you know, into the fall, and it was disruptive. I'll just leave it at that. It was disruptive for this, not just for us, but for the ships coming in to overwinter here. So. And on top of that, the Coast Guard uses a system to assess when ice breaking is adequate, when it's successful. Their metric for success is as long as none of their tier one waterways are blocked for more than a day, and blocked for more than a day in both directions. So, you know, suffice it to say, there are no tier one waterways in Lake Superior. So they're always successful in Lake Superior, and we can tell you otherwise. So there's also a proposal before Congress for the Great Lakes Winter Ice Breaking Act, I believe it's called, that provides new performance metrics for the Coast Guard when it comes to ice breaking on the Great Lakes. And that's a really important piece of it as well.
Great, thank you. We're quickly running out of time. We haven't spent too much time on both resilience, which came up, and sustainability. Maybe one of you could make a few quick remarks on sort of how we are marrying up the need for resilience, our drive towards sustainability, and our efforts to grow our cargo.
Yeah, so across the Great Lakes, Green Marine was started within the Great Lakes. So it's a self-improvement ISO sort of program in which annually we take stock, and then every 2 years we are audited by the organization. It's grown now into an international phenomenon. So that was started here in the Great Lakes. So I think that's important for sustainability and our recognition of the valuable asset that we apply every day. From a very specific standpoint, we've been here in Indiana and focusing on our own electrical resiliency. We're currently examining a microgrid across the port structure with the idea that we will be able to plug in to the next sustainable energy source. We're looking at green hydrogen as a possibility, sun, solar, geotech. We've put everything on the table in our study. And that's not just a study. We have money set aside for a pilot project at the end of this study. And we see this as a kind of a 6 to 9 year progressive state of building upon sustainability and really towards a more sustainable energy source.
Great, thank you. Well, there's so much more we could talk about and we could keep going, but I think we've run out of time. So I'm gonna throw it back to Dave and Erica for any wrap up. I wanna thank our panelists. Great job elaborating on this critically important topic.
Thank you, Will, and thank you to our panelists.